Now to our speaker. Glenn Fox is an agricultural and natural resource economist. He has been a member of the Department of Food, Agriculture, and Resource Economics at the University of Guelph since 1985 and served as acting department chair from 2001 to 2002. His research interests are incredibly broad. They include methodology, property rights, and natural resource stewardship, regulatory takings, trade and environment, technological change, and Austrian economics. He's also a senior fellow at Canada's Fraser Institute. Professor Fox previously taught economics at the University of Western Ontario. He received his PhD in agricultural economics at the University of Minnesota and his bachelor's degree from the University of Guelph. Among his academic publications, he has co-edited and contributed several chapters to a book entitled The Economics of Regulation in Agriculture, Compliance with Public and Private Standards. This was published by CABI Publishing in the UK. Professor Fox will lecture on Asymmetric Information and Market Failure, a Market Process Perspective. Professor Fox.
Well, I'd like to express my thanks and gratitude to the conference organizing committee and to John for inviting me to present this lecture. It is a singular honor to be invited to give the Ludwig von Mises Memorial Lecture at the Ludwig von Mises Institute at this conference. And that's honor with a U, because that's the way we spell it where I come from. I bring greetings from the Austrian Scholars of Canada. When we get together, we don't need a room quite this big, but it's a very enthusiastic and committed group. Any other Canadian Austrians here? Very good. Okay, so we'll meet in the phone booth later for our social. Let me give you a little bit of information on my background. My involvement in Austrian economics really was sort of, it was accidental. My first exposure to Austrian thinking was reading a copy of The Road to Serfdom, which I think is the opening act for many of us. My second opening act was a little bit different. I came across a copy of Epistemological Problems of Economics in the university bookstore when I was doing my PhD program. And so that's the second step in my Austrian economics education. That was in about 1981 or 1982. About a decade later, I met Walter Block when he was at the Fraser Institute in Vancouver. And then I took a short course in Austrian economics from the Foundation for Economic Education. And Roger Garrison was one of the lecturers, as well as others. When I was in graduate school, there were two factions among my professors and among my classmates. And the one faction I used to refer to as the Chicago Perfect Market School. And the other faction I later came to refer to as the Cambridge Market Failure School. Much to the chagrin of both sides, I used to disagree with both of them. And I infuriated them more than they infuriated each other. And the position was, okay, you don't have to be one of us, but you can't not be one of us and not be one of them, because there only are two teams. And I was clearly not part of those two teams, but I didn't realize that until some years later when I read essentially at one sitting Human Action. And I can remember to this day, even though that was probably 25 years ago, the intellectual thrill that I felt when I read the last page of that book and closed the cover, and the how awestruck I was at the intellectual achievement that is represented in that book. And at that point, I realized there's a third team, that I don't have to be one of the two teams. Joe, in his introduction, mentioned that I'm an agricultural economist. That may seem odd to you to have an agricultural economist giving the Mises lecture, but I did check in the fourth edition of Human Action. Mises makes reference to agriculture and agricultural almost 60 times. So I'm going to claim him as a founding member of agricultural economics. Anybody that in one book can talk about agriculture 60 times. If that doesn't qualify you as an agricultural economist, I don't know what does. Okay, so I want to talk to you today about some work on what might strike you as an esoteric topic from economic theory, particularly modern welfare economics. For the students in the audience, you may have come across some of these ideas. Typically, these are things that get students get exposed to at the PhD level. And in fact, my talk today really is the outgrowth of a conversation that I had in one of our PhD students' dissertation defenses when he was talking about asymmetric information and market failure. And so he and I engaged in a dialogue, which we've been doing ever since. And so part of my remarks today are a reflection of that. So anyway, I want to talk to you about this concept of asymmetric information, which is an idea from contemporary what's called welfare economics theory. You don't have to know a lot of welfare economics to understand what I'm going to talk about. I want to contrast what I call the Walrasian-Javonsian neoclassical perspective with the Mengerian neoclassical perspective. And this is a reflection, this awkward language is a reflection of a problem that I've had over the years. I've often heard people make a distinction between neoclassical economics and Austrian economics. And when I was new to Austrian economics, I used to make that distinction myself. But then I realized that of all the three neoclassical revolutionaries, Menger has the greatest claim to neoclassical. And so I don't think that Austrians should abandon the neoclassical name, because Menger was the most quintessential neoclassical. And so that's why I use this somewhat awkward nomenclature of Walrasian, Javonsian neoclassical versus Mengerian. I want to talk about particularly some work by George Akerlof, who is the author that PhD students study when they study welfare economics, and they learn about asymmetric information in a paper called The Market for Lemons. And again, I'm an agricultural economist, so you think the market for lemons, it's about demand and supply conditions in the markets for citrus fruit. No, it's not. It's a metaphor. The market for lemons is the metaphor that people used to use to describe a defective automobile. Okay. So I want to review how the concept of asymmetric information is used in the context of Akerlof's paper, but then also illustrate how the concept of asymmetric information is pervasive and I think treated much more insightfully in the Mengerian neoclassical tradition. Okay. And then I want to talk just briefly and get down to what I think Akerlof really had in mind, what Walrasian neoclassicals really have in mind with this problem of asymmetric information, and how we can help them, essentially. Okay. So asymmetric information is a somewhat new category in what's called market failure theory in modern welfare economics. It didn't originate, but sort of the singular contribution here is a paper by Akerlof published in 1970 called The Market for Lemons. And it was motivated by a number of phenomena, not the least of which is if you buy a new car and then drive it off the lot and then want to sell it, I don't know why you would ever do this, but if you wanted to sell it like an hour after you drove it off the lot, would you get back all your money? And generally the experience is no, you wouldn't. Well, why is that? It also has to do with used cars with defects. Why would anybody sell a used car unless there was something wrong with it? Why would you buy a used car knowing that the only reason that anybody would sell a used car is that there's something wrong with it? Why would you want to buy somebody else's problem? So this is the general motivation. Sellers know the defects, buyers don't. And this is called asymmetric information. And it's been applied more broadly just than in the market for used cars. The prediction is that there, in fact, would either be very few transactions or there would be no transactions at all for used cars or products associated with this. So the generalization is that asymmetric information leads to inefficiency, that's a market failure, and that government policy needs to be implemented in order to fix that. Okay. I have some quotations. Akerlof received the Nobel Prize for this paper. And there was kind of a review paper published the next year or contemporaneously with his Nobel Prize award. And the authors of that paper, describing Akerlof's paper, said that it is probably the single most important contribution to the literature on the economics of information, which is not a small honor. And that there were co-recipients, Michael Spence and Joseph Stiglitz, at the same time, transform the way economists think about the functioning of markets, which I think is a factually correct statement if we think about most economists. Whether it is a normative statement, whether it's an ought-to-be statement, I'm going to quarrel with that in a little bit. I want to talk about what I call a market process perspective on asymmetric information, or a Mengerian neoclassical perspective. The Javonesian, Walrasian perspective is really built on a foundation of perfect competition theory, and any departure from perfect competition represents a problem of efficiency. One of the requirements of perfect competition is that everyone involved, everyone in the world, be completely and perfectly informed about everything. And that any departures from that constitute market failures. And so, of course, if a buyer knows different things than a seller, that's a departure from this assumption, and that triggers the diagnosis of some sort of policy response. Even within this tradition, however, there is a recognition in public choice theory, for example, that market failure is a necessary but not a sufficient condition to justify government action. Typically, that condition is sort of glossed over, but even in that tradition, it's recognized. However, when we look at this problem from a market process perspective, here we have not an equilibrium model, but a disequilibrium model with distributed knowledge. The nature of the situation is that we have distributed knowledge among individuals, and that we don't all know the same thing. And some of the things that we know can't all be right, because I might know something and you might know the opposite, so we can't both be right. And in that context, impediments to voluntary cooperation, impediments to voluntary exchange, are what constitute failures. They might be market failures, or they might be non-market failures. Okay, Akerlof makes four assumptions, which turn out to be pivotal in illustrating the difference between the Walrasian, Javonesian approach and the Mengerian approach. The first assumption is that there are variations in quality for a category of goods or services under consideration. I don't think that that's a controversial assumption. I think that everybody in this room could accept that for any category of goods you might want to think of, there are variations in quality. Okay. Second assumption, however, turns out to be more important and is a clearer indication of how the market process differs from the perspective that Akerlof took. First, he assumes that buyers cannot assess the quality of units of the good or service in question, but sellers can. Okay. Sellers can know whether it's high quality, low quality, mediocre quality, but buyers cannot. Third assumption is that all units of the good or service must be sold at the same price. Okay. Fourth assumption, and this is really related to the second one, is that any services that might arise in what I would call independent verification of quality services, that they can't arise because they are what Akerlof calls non-atomistic. That is, a competitive service for third-party verification can't happen. Okay, so these are the four assumptions, and the three of which I think are critical from our point of view. I don't think that the market process approach would in any way quarrel with assumption number one. So the prediction is, as I said earlier, either a sharply reduced number or zero transactions would take place, because buyers would never want to buy somebody else's problem. Roderick Long has differentiated between two types of abstraction, and I think applying his distinction to this situation really is helpful to illustrate how the market process perspective is different. Three of the assumptions, two, three, and four, are examples of what Long calls precisive abstraction. And Long's a philosopher, and I'm not, and I always get these words between this distinction between precisive and non-precisive abstraction. I have trouble keeping it straight in my mind. But precisive abstraction means specifying that something has some characteristic, or more particularly, does not have some characteristic. So the precisive abstraction in assumption number two is that buyers cannot learn or discover the quality of the thing it is that they're thinking of purchasing. Okay? And he goes on to say that those who criticize abstraction in the Walrasian, Javonesian tradition on the grounds of lack of realism aren't asking for more precisive abstractions, they're asking for non-precisive abstraction. He talks about non-precisive abstractions are things that apply in the same way to every single example of the thing in question. Okay, so the use of abstraction in market process theory tends to be non-precisive abstraction, whereas Akerlof's assumptions are examples of precisive abstractions. Okay, it turns out that asymmetric information has a very well-developed history in the Mengerian-Walrasian tradition, going right back to Menger's theory of exchange. But asymmetric information is not a category of market failure. In fact, it's probably better seen as a market function rather than a market failure. Okay? Menger's theory of exchange, the theory of entrepreneurial alertness is another example where the market process perspective emphasizes asymmetric information. The economic calculation debate was a debate about asymmetric information. The Austrian business cycle theory is another example of asymmetric information. And Tom DiLorenzo a few years ago, I'll pay homage to Tom's contribution in essentially international relations. He pointed out that U.S. foreign policy is an example of a situation of asymmetric information, that the voters really don't know what their government is doing for their benefit and on their behalf. Am I getting it roughly correct, Tom? That quotation. So Menger's theory of exchange, going back to the putative founder of the market process perspective, Menger's theory of bilateral exchange is a theory based on an assumption of asymmetric information. Just to read you a brief quotation from Menger, the benefits of a mutual transfer of goods depend on three conditions. A, one economizing individual must have command of the quantities of goods which have a smaller value to him than other quantities of goods at the disposal of another economizing individual who evaluates the goods in reverse fashion. Okay? Voluntary exchange doesn't take place unless there is this asymmetric valuation. I want what you have more than what I have, and you want what I have more than what you have. That's asymmetric information. Without asymmetric information, there would never be a market exchange. And that was one of the breakthroughs, because for hundreds, if not thousands of years, social theorists seem to believe that what happened in market exchange was people exchanged things of equal value. Along came Menger and said, that doesn't make any sense. People exchange things of unequal value. The conditions that Menger lays out, he says, the absence of one of these conditions means that an essential prerequisite for an economic exchange is missing, i.e. no asymmetric information, no asymmetric valuation, no exchange. Okay? So asymmetric information is at the very heart, the very origin of the market process perspective on market exchange. The theory of entrepreneurial alertness, developed by Mises and also Kirzner and others, the definition of entrepreneurial alertness is that one individual notices something that no one else has noticed. Maybe even that same person 10 minutes ago. Okay? So entrepreneurial alertness is another example of asymmetric information. The entrepreneur perceives something that nobody else perceives. So by definition, that's asymmetric information. The entrepreneur knows something that other people don't. Of course, not all entrepreneurial perceptions prove to be valid, prove to be accurate. There are a lot of things that we believe might happen that don't turn out to be the case. So people have to act on their entrepreneurial perceptions in order to test their validity. And this is why Hayek's essay, Competition as a Discovery Procedure, is so insightful and so important. Because in that he explains that no one can know a priori whether these entrepreneurial perceptions are valid or not. And it's only through this rivalrous competitive process that that this testing takes place. And then when the testing takes place, then other people get to know. So competition is the process that tests these asymmetrical perceptions that in the perceptions of entrepreneurs. Okay? The economic calculation debate is another context in which the market process perspective has investigated and applied the concept of asymmetric information. Hayek in 1945 differentiated between scientific knowledge and what he called the knowledge of the particular circumstances of time and place, I really wish he'd had a more compact way to say that. It takes a long time in class to get students to remember that category. But the point is that a lot of knowledge, a lot of information in society is distributed in human heads, and it's not necessarily even things that we can express. But knowledge of the particular circumstances of time and place are behind a lot of what we do as people. They animate quite a bit, if not the substantial share, of human action. But this second category of knowledge is fragmented, it's conflicted, it's subjective, and it may even be something that we can't articulate to ourselves or others. And the price system, according to Hayek, mobilizes this distributed, fragmented, inconsistent knowledge and allows people to, and it resolves conflicts over the differences in the knowledge of the particular circumstances of time and place. In the economic calculation debate, pity the poor central planning board. Wonder if we could just pause and be sorry for the person or persons that are charged with somehow figuring out what the best use of all of the means of production happen to be in a society when they can't access. So they face an asymmetric information problem, that the people know stuff that the central planning board doesn't know and can't know. Okay? Now, we don't think of that as a market failure, obviously. The market process says that that's a non-market failure, that's a policy failure, that the central planning board faces a problem of asymmetric information that impedes its ability to allocate goods, particularly goods of higher order, among their competing employments. Another area where market process theory deals with problems of asymmetric information is in Austrian business cycle theory. Mises and others in the Austrian tradition articulated a business cycle theory, which is in some respects a monetary phenomenon, that it's disturbances in the money and credit system, that and it's based on a theory of asymmetric information. Rothbard characterizes the bust portion of the business cycle as a situation, the downturn as it is, as a clustering of entrepreneurial errors. A bunching up of that an above normal rate of entrepreneurial error happens in the downturn part of the business cycle. Now, in the normal operation of the price system, we expect some entrepreneurial perceptions to be correct, but it's normal for some of them to be incorrect. So entrepreneurial failure is a normal part of the price system. Sometimes we get a little bit blinded and emphasize the entrepreneurial success, but the entrepreneurial failure is another important and necessary part of the price system. But in the downturn portion of a business cycle, for some reason, a higher number, a higher rate, an above average number of entrepreneurial perceptions turn out to be wrong. So why is that? Well, the theory essentially appeals to a problem of asymmetric information. Okay. That under particular circumstances, particularly disturbances in the money and credit system, the rate of entrepreneurial error rises. Well, why does it rise? Well, entrepreneurs are not able to distinguish between what the price system at its sort of fundamental level is trying to tell them and what the distortions introduced by the disturbance in money and credit are telling them, which are, in a sense, false signals. Okay? Now, this is a little bit difficult to characterize as an asymmetric information problem, because it may be that even the people doing the disturbance of the money and credit system, they may not know either what they're doing, particularly if they think that expanding the money supply works through a helicopter money model, then even the people doing the expansion of credit may not understand the distributed effects on different prices at different rates at different places and times. Might have, but certainly we can see that the entrepreneurs face a problem of asymmetric information, that they're looking at these things called price signals, and they trust them, but in a sense they shouldn't trust them. Okay. Again, it's a problem of asymmetric information, but it's not a problem of market failure. Typically we think of that as some interference with the market process that creates the problem of market failure, which leads to this above normal rate of entrepreneurial failure. A few years ago, I came across a paper by Professor Eric Bond. Now, I don't know Eric, I've read this paper and I've taught it to my students, and I think it's a very useful paper. It's an empirical study of the United States used pickup truck market. And I don't know Eric's background, and so I don't know what the origins of this were, but I can picture Eric as a PhD student thinking, well, here's this paper that's come out on the market for lemons, and it makes predictions about used vehicle sales, but it's a theoretical paper, and nobody's done an empirical study, and one thing that PhD students kind of gravitate toward doing is, let's take a theoretical paper, and I'll do an empirical study and see if I can measure whatever the effect is. So I don't know whether this was Eric's thought process or not, but it very well could have been. I'm speculating. And of course, if there is a place where one might consider going to look for a lemons effect, you'd be hard-pressed to find a better location than the used pickup truck market. Now, you may not have any firsthand experience with used pickup trucks. I do. And if you're going to search for lemons, here's where my pictures come in. And they're pictures of used pickup trucks. And in the vernacular of, in the rural vernacular, pickup trucks are a vehicle which are often road hard and put away wet. These are not mine. Now, I drive a pickup truck, but it's a professorial pickup truck. It has a bit of a pampered life. but non-professorial pickup trucks don't have quite the pampered life that my pampered little Tacoma does. And so I have some pictures of used pickup trucks, and they're supposed to scare you. So I'd like you all to pretend to be scared right now at the pictures of these used pickup trucks. Maybe I should have had a trigger warning that I'm going to show you pictures of used pickup trucks, and sensitive viewers may be offended at this. So what did Eric Bond find in his search for lemons? Well, he found that there is, thank you, a very active and robust market in used pickup trucks in the United States. If you're not involved in the market for used pickup trucks, this may or may not surprise you. It didn't surprise me, given my personal experience. Well, how can this be? And this is where I think the really valuable part of his research applies. And he said that, well, first, owners can, in fact, acquire their own personal knowledge from their own experience about how to judge the quality of a pickup truck. This may not surprise any of you, but given the background, you know, it is contrary to one of the assumptions. He also observed that there was a well-developed market in a secondary market in verification services. People can check, and of course, this is more well-developed now than it was when Eric did his research in the 80s. Now there are all kinds of resources that you can get. You can access as a potential buyer to learn about the history of a vehicle. There are independent mechanical inspections that can be obtained competitively at relatively low cost. You can examine service records. There's the reputation of the seller. There are now car dealerships that specialize in selling used vehicles. That's all they sell. And they offer warranties and inspections and so forth. So in other words, social adaptations have emerged to address this lemons problem, and seem to be quite effective. The most and the important part of this is that they are not non-atomistic. That is, that they are very competitive, and access to these services is not in any way difficult for someone thinking about purchasing a used pickup truck. Okay, the irony is that. Professor Akerlof got the Nobel Prize, and Eric Bond was not named as a co-recipient of the Nobel Prize. Of course, this is the complaint of empirical economists from time immemorial, right? That the theory guys get all the glory, and the empirical guys that actually go out and test and measure are doing the grunt work that doesn't get the recognition. But if I were on the Nobel Committee, I would certainly want to put in a vote for Eric Bond for doing this work. But I don't want to be dismissive of what the Walrasian, Javonesian economists are worrying about. I think that they have a valid worry, but it's not expressed very well. And I think here's where we can help them. I think what they're really worried about is not asymmetric information. I think they use that term and it's overly broad. It's an overgeneralization. What they're really worried about is fraud. Okay? And it turns out market process economists are also worried about fraud. I think we all agree that fraud is a bad thing. I don't know about Walter. Maybe Walter. I can't remember if Walter's got a chapter about defending the undefendable, defending the fraudster. I forgot to check that chapter before I correct name. So I could, in the Q&A, maybe I'll be corrected. I worry about fraud. Let me say that. I won't generalize for any of you. Okay? I'm worried about a situation where the seller maintains that a good is of a particular quality, and the buyer takes that at good faith, and then finds out that it's not the case. So it's a misrepresentation. Okay? And what do we do about that? Because I think that's what the market for lemons was really about, and it was just too broadly expressed. Well, one of the things that I think that we can that we should recognize as economists, and it doesn't matter whether we're in the Walrasian, Jevonsian tradition or the Mengerian tradition, is let's not assume when we identify a problem that we're the first people on the planet who've ever thought about that problem. I think that's just a good practice of modesty. Maybe other professionals, maybe other disciplines have thought about this before. Let's go see if we can learn from what they've learned build on that. Okay, so the economic research program to study fraud, I'm going to say that there's two broad options that could be pursued if fraud is the focus of our investigation. One will be to construct a hypothetical situation in which fraud exists, and then compare the efficiency properties in some perfect competition sense of that situation to a parallel hypothetical situation where fraud doesn't exist. Okay? That'd be one approach, kind of a thought experiment, if you will. And essentially, I think that's what Akerlof was doing and others. But the problem is that they assumed that they were the first people that ever stumbled across this problem. Right? And as a result, they were not able to avail themselves of the wisdom and experience of others. It also could be seen as what Harold Nemseth's called the Nirvana approach. Let's compare an actual situation to an ideal perfect situation and see which one's better. Right? Nemseth's called that the Nirvana approach. I call it the ideal husband approach. I realized there was a movie. I used this in class, and none of the students had even heard of this movie, but this is an older crowd, so maybe you've heard of the movie The Ideal Husband. I've not seen the movie myself. Yeah, see, everybody, you know, of a younger generation looking at it has never heard of this movie. Anyway, there's a movie called The Ideal Husband. When this movie came out, I was friends with a couple that I'd met shortly after I arrived in Guelph, an older couple that had probably the best relationship that I'd ever seen. I aspired to have a relationship half as good as their relationship. And one day, Jim, the husband, came to me and he said, "My wife and I have rented a movie. We're going to watch it tonight." And I said, "Oh, what's the movie, Jim?" He said, "It's The Ideal Husband." I said, "Jim, don't watch that movie." And Jim said, "Well, what do you mean? Is it a bad movie? Have you seen the movie?" I said, "Jim, I haven't seen the movie, but don't watch it." He said, "Well, what do you mean? You haven't even seen the movie and you're telling me don't watch the movie? That's crazy. Why should you?" I said, "Jim, just don't watch. Take it from me. I know I'm younger than you are. I don't have your experience. Just don't watch the movie." And Jim just kind of scoffed and went off and he watched the movie. Okay. And what I observed over the next month is that Jim couldn't dress himself properly. Jim couldn't back the car out of the garage properly. Jim could not put a pair of sunglasses on his face properly. And so a little while later, I took him aside and I said, "Jim, you know what happened? I understand that the husband and the ideal husband is not, in fact, an ideal husband. There's a certain irony in the title. But the problem is somebody got an idea that there is something called an ideal husband. And guess what, Jim? You're not him." Okay? Well, I think we have an ideal husband problem or a Nirvana approach problem in the problem of asymmetric information in this approach. Another option, which I call the modesty option, is let's try and figure out what other disciplines have learned about this problem of tackling fraud. Well, what are some of the other disciplines? Well, accounting. Accountants spend apparently all their waking hours thinking about problems of fraud, particularly auditors. Okay, so there are principles and procedures in auditing, and we all know that they're not perfect. You know, we can all cite the big business failure problems when that was not perfect, but anyway, they've thought about it a long time and they've set up situations to deal with it. In law, contract law, again, a body of practice in which people have dealt with problems of asymmetric information for hundreds of years, if not more than that. Sociology and anthropology have dealt with kinship and ethnic trading communities in particular, and how those communities have set up relationships, have evolved practices to deal with fraudulent behavior, and in particular, the sanctions that they've developed in those contexts to deal with people who don't abide by the accepted code of ethics or practice. And then elsewhere in economics, there are people, and here's where I think the market process perspective has been most helpful, is people who've done studies on the economics of trust and reputation. And there's been a lot of contributions in the Austrian tradition, in the Mengarian tradition on that. So option number two would be, let's look at what these other disciplines, let's look at what these other scholars have learned when they've tackled this problem and see. But this is not generally what's happened. This is not what my PhD students come back to me and talk about after they've taken their welfare economics courses. They don't come back and say, hey, we had a stimulating lecture on contract law today, and I don't worry so much about asymmetric information as I used to. Okay, so just to wrap up with some concluding comments, I think that the existing literature, which is not dominated by the market process perspective, is excessively broad in when it talks about this problem of asymmetric information. A better understanding of the price system is that the price system rests foundationally on a condition of asymmetric information. Without asymmetric information, we would not have any exchanges, we wouldn't have any prices. And we wouldn't be able to get this indirect information that we get from prices about these subjective values that people carry around in their heads. Okay? The price system mobilizes and tests this asymmetric information as part of the ongoing dynamics of the exchange process. What most economists outside the market process tradition, I think, really have in mind is fraud, as I've said earlier. And that it would be better for them to use that term and then focus their inquiry specifically on tackling that. But the literature that I'm referring to today has largely limited its attention this perfect competition, ideal husband, Nirvana approach, which it has ignored non-market failure problems that give rise to asymmetric information. Problems. Okay. At a deeper level, I think that this topic is an illustration of some of the fundamental differences between what I've been referring to as the Javonesian, Walrasian approach in neoclassical economics to the Mengarian approach. That if we look at the problem of asymmetric information from a market process perspective, we really see it quite differently. We have a different understanding of the phenomenon. There are different methodological differences. What's the nature of how we do scientific economics comes to bear here? And what normative criteria do we apply to a situation? Dishonesty or fraud in market exchanges, I think, is a valid concern. I worry about it. I suspect some of you worry about it as well. But more productive avenues of inquiry are available. And I think a market process perspective can actually help quite a bit in understanding this problem. So that's those were my remarks. Thank you.